Good evening. Welcome to Q&A. I'm Tony Jones, and answering your questions tonight, leader of the Palmer United Party, Clive Palmer, the Shadow Minister for Infrastructure, Anthony Albanese, Gulf War veteran and head of the US Army Wellbeing Project, Brigadier General Rhonda Cornum, ACTU President Jed Kearney, and the Minister, the Assistant Minister for Infrastructure and Development, Jamie Briggs. Please welcome our panel. Thank you. And as usual, we're being simulcast on ABC News 24 and News Radio, and you can join the Twitter conversation or send us a question by using the Qanda hashtag that just appeared on your screen. Well, our first question tonight comes from Sarah Whitby.
After the recent riots on Manus Island, it has become obvious that Tony Abbott has an addiction to secrecy, particularly when it comes to Operation Sovereign Borders. Scott Morrison has criticised journalists for raising reports that contradict his statements, but he himself has only provided information that succeed only in raising concern and intrigue. How does a government justify its decision to deprive its people of accurate and detailed information?
Jamie Briggs, let's start with you.
Funny that, Tony. Well, look, I don't think doing five press conferences in a week is being secretive, and that's what Scott's done. It is a very difficult issue. There are no easy solutions to fixing the crisis of the borders that we found when we came to government in 2013, last September. But what you've seen over the last 67 days is no boats arrive. Over the last 5 years before the change of government in September 2013, you saw over 1,000 people die at sea. So we think that preventing those deaths in the first place, although through what are, you know, tough measures, is a far better policy than having our borders porous like they were, encouraging the people smugglers back into business.
We've also seen a man die in a detention centre, though originally the minister said it happened outside the detention centre and sort of blamed him, in effect, for being outside the detention centre. There's going to be an inquiry now, but, well, in a way, a bit typically, that inquiry is largely going to focus on the previous government.
Well, look, I don't think Scott ever blamed anyone for a death. I think that's not a reasonable summary of what he did. In fact, he said in the first press conference where he said there was evidence that he was outside the centre that it wasn't conclusive. And as the week went on, he updated. Obviously, this information is coming from PNG. We're operating across jurisdictions. It is a very complicated set of circumstances. Of course, a death is terrible. It's a terrible occurrence. Where
they do have telephones there, don't they?
They do, but what Scott did was send his assistant secretary of his department and General Campbell from the Operation Sovereign Borders to investigate. He got more evidence, and on Saturday night, when he had more conclusive evidence, he presented that evidence. It is a very awful situation when someone dies, but the policy is to prevent more deaths at sea. I saw today someone talk about blood on people's hands. I mean, that sort of emotive language is pretty unhelpful in this debate. But, you know, if we go back a couple of years, there was a boat smashed up at rocks on Christmas Island. We don't want to see that again.
Anthony Albanese. Oh, I'm sorry, Jed Kearney. I'll just hear from Anthony Albanese. I'll come back to you in a second.
Well, what we need is transparency. At no stage prior to the election did the incoming government say that they would stop the information. And that's what we're seeing here. We're seeing no information to journalists, no information to the parliament, but more importantly, no information to the Australian people. You had a circumstance whereby Scott Morrison said that people would be safe if they stayed within the perimeters at Manus Island. Clearly, with the tragic death of this individual, what we see is that this person wasn't safe. And that information that the incident occurred inside the centre was put out at 9 o'clock on Saturday night, too late to get onto the news, too late to get into the newspapers. And today in Parliament, Scott Morrison refused to be accountable to the Parliament and say when he got that information. If it's good enough to embed journalists during wartime with the Australian Defence Force, it's good enough for there to be openness and transparency about what is being done in our name.
Rhonda Cormann, how does this look to an outsider? You've been in Adelaide for a little while, a part of the Thinkers in Residence program. Have you had a chance to think about this?
Well, I certainly have watched the news, as has everyone else. I think it's a very difficult question. I think we in America certainly are familiar with people coming across your borders illegally and seeking whatever they're seeking. And there's never a good answer. It does seem like they have done everything they can do to make it as safe and as they can, and that's about all I can say.
Would you consider rounding up Mexicans who come over the border and putting them on a Pacific island?
No. Can't say that I would ever do that. but I would be really happy if we had an ocean in between.
Good point. Jed Kearney.
I just wanted to say that I think what's missing is you seem to focus on, you know, stopping in this end, and we're talking about transparency. What is completely lacking is compassion. You can't abrogate yourself from the responsibility of people being in detention.
Well, Jed, it's not compassionate for people to die at sea.
It's compassionate, but there are people in your care Jamie, right now, that are deserving of compassion and humane treatment.
Well, and, you know, if you encourage people smugglers to put people on boats, women, children, adults, and they die at sea, how's that compassionate exactly?
It is compassionate for the people who are in your care. You can't weasel your way
out of
it, Jamie.
Well, there's 1,000 people. No. We're not going to weasel out of the fact there was 1,000 people who died in the 5 years after Labor Week and the border protection.
And now a man is dead in your care.
Well, and it is terrible, and there'll be an inquiry into why.
Okay.
But there should be an inquiry into why there was 1,000 people who died over those 5 years.
Let me interrupt you to go to the other side of the panel. Clive Palmer, I could hear you saying, that's right. Now, the questioner made the point, in fact, asked the question or suggested the government is addicted to secrecy. The public is being deprived of accurate and detailed information. Is that the way you see it?
Well, I think, as it was said, an injustice done to one man anywhere is an injustice to all men everywhere. And it's no excuse to say that because people have drowned somewhere is a reason why Australian security guards retained by our government should kill another person. Mm. That's the reality of it. Mm. And someone has died. It is a tragedy. And the real question to ask now is, are those same exact Papuan security guards being transferred this minute to work for another security company? Have they just changed companies and kept the same guards? I think you'll find that's the case.
Let's move on. Our next question is a video. It's from Rebecca Weber in Clifton Hill, Melbourne.
Minister Albanese, how can the Australian Labor Party stand by in silence and watch what is happening on Manus Island? Does the ALP believe that Australia is now a nation that treats vulnerable people seeking our help with cruelty and inhumanity? Is the Minister and the ALP proud that Australia can now claim to be deterring the small number of refugees that arrive here seeking our protection by subjecting them to conditions worse than that which they have fled?
Anthony Albanese.
Well, with respect, of course, we're not the government. We are, in terms of, we've asked questions in the Parliament. I certainly agree with Jed that we need a compassionate response. That doesn't mean that you have an open borders policy. It does mean, though, that you have to look, give proper care to people who you are responsible for. And I want to make sure that that does occur. It's not clear the circumstances that occurred here. It's also not clear a range of other information. What has happened to the people who've been put on these orange dinghies that have been sent back? What happens to them then? We need actually to have a transparent system, and there's a reason for that, because with transparency comes accountability. It's not just an academic exercise. And I think if you compare Tony Burke, the role that he played as immigration minister, where you didn't have vilification of people, where you had proper information and accountability.
Can I just interrupt you on the question of accountability? The Labor government set up this facility. The minister, Scott Morrison, says he inherited a mess. The centre was under-resourced, under capacity, and security arrangements were deficient. Now, he's changed the security arrangements. But do you have any responsibility when something like this goes pear-shaped only months after you leave government?
Well, he says a range of things that are rhetorical and blames everything on the former government. He is responsible for the management that is going on right now. And what's more...
But hang on, can I just get that he is inherited. He has inherited
what you set up. We're responsible for what occurred up to September 7, yes. We are not responsible for the circumstances in terms of whereby we can't even find out what is going on. And in Parliament today, you have a minister who essentially refuses to answer questions.
But I'll put this to you. You're also responsible for putting G4S in charge of security there. And so I'll ask you this. Was it under Labor's watch that a former Sri Lankan military officer, Dinesh Pereira, was given a management role at a centre dealing with people coming from Sri Lanka, among others?
Well, I've seen that there's a report about that.
He's been spoken to by the ABC. He's admitted that he was a former Sri Lankan military officer.
Indeed, and there's a report about that this evening. I'm not an expert on this person. I was travelling up from Canberra, so I'm not going to comment on the run about the circumstances of this gentleman. What I'll say is that we're responsible for what we were in charge of. We are responsible and we do accept that, but we can't on an ongoing basis, when you had an opposition that ran around and had billboards, running billboards with numbers up, you couldn't get Scott Morrison to not talk about the number of arrivals and what was going on. Now, apparently, that's all assisting the people smugglers.
Let's quickly go to Clive Palmer. You're listening to that. I mean, you've been critical of the government. What about the opposition?
Well, I think the main question really is that the Manus solution has failed. We haven't got good security there. The Papua New Guinea government won't allow Australian police, immigration, or any of our security officers to have any real authority. It's not backed by any legislative authority in PNG or here. The whole operation's illegal. It doesn't mean the coalition's stop the boats policy has to change. It's just Manus Island we're talking about, where it's been demonstrated that security is inadequate. So we don't want the coalition to be too sensitive or the Labor Party to be sensitive. It's not a matter about blaming people. It's trying to save people's lives in the future. That's what's more important.
Let's move on. We've got a lot of questions to get through on different subjects. We'll move to another issue. And our next question comes from Patrick Michel.
My question is to the panel. Now, prospects over the next 5 to 10 years look grim for young Australians to have stable, well-paid employment in a service-only economy. Little manufacturing now. To be able to afford a home anywhere exists amongst outdated, poorly planned infrastructure. The G20 tells us to go for growth, as Australian governments seem to go for cuts. Is this just a rosy picture we're being sold? Because I truly believe there is no plan for the future other than dirt digging and house flipping. What is the plan?
Jed Carney, we'll go to you first and then we'll hear from the politicians afterwards.
Well, you've absolutely put it beautifully. I think that is the quintessential question that this government has to answer, and it's got absolutely no policies whatsoever about it. We have heard them say that they want growth. That's fine. We want growth. Everybody wants a strong economy that is growing, because that does mean more jobs. But every other policy that they seem to be talking about is the exact antithesis of creating jobs. They have taken away co-investment from the car industry and from other manufacturing industries that we've seen them just disappear, thousands of jobs disappearing from manufacturing. You're absolutely right. What point is a robust service industry without manufacturing, which is the heart of the economy? We have high unemployment and yet we have no policies to actually create skills, to create apprenticeships.
Can I just interrupt you there? Because today we just got the youth unemployment figures. 20% in Cairns and large parts of Tasmania, youth unemployment. 18 to 19% in North Adelaide, more than 17% in Western Sydney, the Illawarra and Melbourne and regional Victoria.
This is a worry.
What sort of plan might fix this?
Well, I think there's a lot we can do. First of all, we can actually invest in our education system. We can rebuild our TAFE system. We can fix the VET system. We can make sure that there are apprenticeships for young people, that manufacturing is viable, because that's where a lot of the apprenticeships are. We can make sure that we don't have really bizarre policies like making people work till they're 70 when there's young people wanting to come through into the workforce. We can actually look at the huge number of people that are here on working holiday visas that are doing jobs that maybe our kids could do as labour market entry jobs. I think there's a lot we could be doing, but all this government seems to be doing is the exact opposite.
All right, we'll go to Jamie Briggs. Jobs. Now, the questioner asks, how could Joe Hockey go for growth and big spending cuts at the same time? Is it possible?
Well, it just... A couple of points. Firstly, I don't believe manufacturing is dead, not at all. In fact, manufacturing is prospering in many parts of our economy. Some parts are under pressure, no doubt about that. But if subsidising the car industry forever and a day was a great idea, why has the north part of Adelaide got the highest unemployment across the country? I mean, that's the reality. It's not an answer.
With respect, can you demonstrate where it's thriving and where it's not thriving?
Manufacturing.
Well, there are different parts of the economy where it is thriving.
Which parts?
Well, there are businesses. There are businesses in South Australia, in Adelaide, for instance, that are doing very well at the moment. There is a start-up business in the eastern suburbs who makes equipment for the mining industry, which has gone from being a one-man operation to employing over 100 people in a matter of 6 years. There are great stories that we celebrate, and they didn't need government subsidies in the first place to get there. You know, as far as car subsidies go...
I acknowledge that, but we're seeing a backward slip.
You should come into Parliament, mate. You'd be good at it. If you go back to when John Button, the Labor industry minister, said in the 1980s that you need industry assistance which is targeted and short-term because that is the best way to help industries adjust. After 30 years, it's not unreasonable for people to say, how short-term is this? The reality is that governments don't create jobs, businesses do.
Jamie, can I just interrupt there?
That is not true, Jamie.
Well, it is true, Jed. I mean, the fact of the matter is...
But the government has to have policies in place that
will... I'll let you interrupt while I'm speaking.
Thank you. For example, the government is talking about getting rid of the renewable energy target, right?
No,
that is, yeah, well, when, there,
when
that
have
is
we
discourse.
Said that?
There
when
is
exactly?
discourse about
no.
OK, so you're going to say now that you are going to keep it.
We are having a review into it, which is a review that Anthony announced when he was Deputy Prime Minister.
I'm going to
legislation.
Well, the renewable energy target would create thousands of jobs in a whole industry.
It is true, by the way, that it was up for review. That is
Thank
true.
You, Tony.
There was a review.
Tony's backing me, see?
But he's not going to say he's going to keep it.
It does look like your review might be looking to end the mandatory renewable energy scheme.
No,
the way the review is put, it looks like it's actually due to
the end. I mean, if we want to look at one of the pressures on the manufacturing industry, high energy costs are certainly a pressure on the manufacturing industry, without a doubt. You cannot have this debate and exclude manufacturing energy costs with the manufacturing industry. One of those factors, of course, is the carbon tax. One of those factors is that the renewable energy target puts upward pressure on electricity prices.
Can I just pause there? Because I think what the questioner is looking for and what a lot of people are looking for is what is the plan?
The plan
to
is,
create jobs. And you're talking about infrastructure. Mm-hmm. You're the Assistant Minister for Infrastructure. So is there, in your mind, in the Cabinet, in the government, an idea for big infrastructure projects which will create jobs?
Absolutely. What we think we should do is cut taxes, cut regulation and build infrastructure to allow all businesses... Sorry, Jed.
Sorry.
You're sleeping.
Sorry. I think we need to let...
Thank you, Tony. We want to cut taxes, we want to cut regulation and we want to build the infrastructure to allow all businesses to compete on an even playing field. With the days of favouring businesses, checkbook government are gone. We've got $500 billion of Labor debt to deal with, deficits for a decade without changing the settings. What we need to do is let our businesses, our entrepreneurial spirit, create the opportunities for the future, not the government deciding where.
OK, you haven't named any projects. I'll just go to Clive Palmer.
Well, there's $36 billion worth of work.
You know, people who are pessimistic about the economy are never going to get out of the pessimism. We've got to have some positive go forward and some confidence. I mean, if we look at Albania, we might find its debt situation looks pretty good. Is that the role model we want to follow? Or if we look at the United States, it hasn't had a surplus for years, but it's a booming economy, and President Obama's pumping in $65 billion every month to stimulate demand to allow businesses to capitalise on that sort of activity. While we find that there's cuts and a shrinkage in Europe, we find the Australian government's doing the same thing. Meanwhile, the US is getting stronger, its exports are getting better. We should follow the US's policies in the economy and give them a hell of a competition in their export markets. Instead of that, they're going to smash everybody in the world because they've got the right economic policies.
Anthony Albanese.
Well, this is a government that had a plan to get into government, but not a plan to govern. And we've seen that again with Jamie's answer before. On the weekend, Joe Hockey spoke about the G20 and growth and global figures. Well, have a look at what they're actually doing. There's not a plan to invest in infrastructure. There One is, of the things that you could rubbish, do, Anthony. You could do is not rip out the money that's already in the budget for the Melbourne Metro and Cross River Rail and these big urban congestion busting public transport projects. You could invest in education and skills for the workforce, educating the skills for the workforce of the future, for the jobs of the future. And yet that's not happening. You could keep Medicare intact rather than ripping it out because you need a healthy workforce. All these things build into productivity growth into the future. There is no plan. There's not a question asked of any government minister in any forum, including the parliament and here, in which you don't get, oh, well, what the former Labor government did. Well, they're in government. They need to actually show that they have a plan to govern, and they're not
Tony,
doing that
I
at the moment.
Tony, can I just say, I mean, the problem is Anthony's a terrific politician. He's very good in opposition. He's well practiced at it. That,
well, but he can't ignore the reality.
I've been in government. Remember.
No, you were in 11 and a half years you had a go at.
And we built 7,500 kilometres of new and improved roads.
Okay,
We've got $36 billion.
Why do argue when the people suffer? That's what I want to know. All we do at Parliament is argue the whole time.
You're never there, Clive. How would you know?
Okay. Okay, let me put this to you because you were talking about South Australian manufacturing earlier, and the South Australian government is crying out for the future submarine project, which will be a government initiative, tens of billions of dollars over decades, to be put into South Australia. In other words, make the decision, build the submarines there. That is a big manufacturing project. It is an infrastructure project.
Yeah.
Win the election. That's what it's about. South Australian election.
Right, sorry. You finished? Right, good. We've got, firstly, to address Anthony's point, we've got $36 billion over the next 4 years in infrastructure investments, which is more
than
what
Labor... That's the money that was there.
No, it's not, mate.
That's
it's
the money
no,
you
no,
have
no,
had.
You've got to be able to finish your point, as I said earlier.
Which is more than what Labor had in their last... going into the election. As far as the submarine contracts are concerned, we'll make the decision, the Defence Minister will make that decision, and it'll be based on good policy, not on industry policy, because the Australian Defence Force and our needs for the defence are far more important than just making decisions on parochial interests. Right. Now, South Australia is
just interrupt
well
you there, because a couple of people with their hands up at the back, and we'll go to the gentleman here first. Go ahead.
She can go first. Yeah.
All right. Chivalry's not dead.
Sorry, I beg your pardon.
Age before beauty. My question to Mr. Albanese, you just listed all the things that the government should be doing. Huh? Why weren't you doing that when you were in government?
We built... We doubled the roads budget and built 7,500 kilometres of new roads or improved roads.
We rebuilt
one in every 3 kilometres of the interstate rail freight system. And we invested more in urban public transport than all governments combined from Federation up to 2000.
OK, can we take that as a summary? Now, this gentleman here wanted to ask a question. We'll go to you.
And the NBN.
Sorry, this gentleman here, go ahead.
I have a question for anybody in the panel, mainly Jamie Briggs. You talk about cutting taxes. Mm-hmm. I'm not from here, as you can tell probably by my accent. I'm from the U.S., but... Obama talks about cutting taxes lift up the heavy weight from the middle class and the working class and bring it towards the 1%. Mm-hmm. Is that your plan? Is that your plan to basically cut taxes out the government? Mm-hmm. And if you're cutting taxes out the government, how are we going to get the money to create new jobs? Because I think a lot of people in Australia are worried about jobs.
Yeah,
and a lot of people have mouths to feed. Yeah. That's just my opinion.
Yeah,
okay,
it's a good question.
You've got 30 seconds because we need to race through it. Go ahead.
Well, governments don't create jobs, businesses do. And if you take the pressure off businesses by unleashing unnecessary taxes like the carbon tax and the mining tax and taxes such as that, you will allow businesses to create more opportunities for young people. As we've heard today, the Labor Party's left us with a youth employment crisis, and that's what we're going to have to address.
Okay, there's one more gentleman there with his hand up at the back. He's been very patient. Go ahead.
Mr. Briggs, you're saying about the unemployment and that, but why are we getting the TAFE colleges and uni colleges, and then you're getting deregulation of them, and you're getting private enterprise companies coming in, or they're just fly-by-nighters, and there's no training facilities for people to get better educated.
Yeah. Well, the TAFE colleges are run by my state counterpart, so when you have a Q&A with the state governments on here, you can turn up and go after them. But ultimately, training is a very important part. A point I agree with Jed is that you do need a good and effective training system and people to have access to it. And you need a varied training system, not just a sort of focus on sending every child to university. We want people to make the most of whatever their talents are. And some of those talents are to pursue training through vocational education. So you do need a strong sector.
Unis struggling as well because they are often the same as TAFE colleges now, so you...
OK, sorry to interrupt you, sir. We've got other panellists who want to jump in. Make your comments brief, if you can.
Australia's the number one petitioner of bankruptcies and liquidations in this country. The Australian government winds up more businesses, stops more employment than any other group in the country. Why haven't we got Chapter 11 like they've got in the United States? If we want to make the domestic economy go, we've got to release more money. How can we do that? We can cut provisional tax. Australian businesses have to pay $70 billion a year in advance now on money they may not make. Why don't we release that, change the date so that they pay their tax once they've earned the money, then they'll have that money in their businesses to stimulate the economy, create more jobs, and we'll get the economy moving. Why don't we do that?
And Jim Carney, briefly, because we've got...
Briefly. We did have, I think, something that's missing quite from this conversation is the very subtle reminders from the spokesperson for the World Bank and the head of the IMF on your show that you can't just have unbridled investment, you can't just have unbridled growth. You have to think about inequality. It has to be targeted. You have to make sure there's enough public spending to invest in health and education. And if you cut too many taxes, you can't do any of those things.
And just quickly before I move on, I just want to hear from Rhonda. You've been listening, once again, you've been listening to this debate. You've probably heard similar debates in the United States.
Well, I certainly agree that businesses create jobs. Small businesses with people have confidence that there is opportunity, they will create jobs, they will start a business, they will create jobs, and there's no question that we can stifle that or we can encourage it.
That leads into our next question, which is from a young person, Annie Fitzer.
Industrial relations reforms always seem to be about bettering conditions for employers, not employees. As a young casual employee in the hospitality industry, the reality is I work when my employer wants me to. How can I have any hope of negotiating on my terms or equal terms? They will just hire somebody else. And why shouldn't I be paid extra work for working the days that and times that no one wants to work?
Jamie Briggs.
There is a range of laws which ensure that you can take the work that you can refuse to take conditions if you don't want to, under which have been built up over many years. The issue with industrial relations legislation is there's a balance. And if you tilt the balance one way too far, you will make it very difficult for employers to be able to actually employ you in the first place to run their businesses, because if they can't run their businesses successfully, then there's no job. And Jed quoted the IMF president, who said on the weekend that the biggest inhibitor to youth getting an opportunity at jobs was overt industrial or employment regulation around the world. So you've got to get the balance right.
So, Jamie Briggs, can I interrupt there? Because obviously everyone wants to know whether you're going to change that. And you'd be aware of calls from employers in the hospitality industry that young woman works in from all around the country to get rid of penalty rates. Is that in the government's sights at all?
Well, no. What we've said is we want the Productivity Commission to have a look at how the regulations are working, and I think this week Senator Abetz is likely to announce the terms of reference in that respect. Penalty rates have been part of the Australian industrial relations landscape for a very long time, and I imagine they'll remain in that respect. But one of the point about the balance is this. There are many restaurants now on Sundays, for instance, who don't open at all, because they can't afford to open at all. Now, we've got to ask ourselves the question, in a 24/7 society, when we all expect to be able to shop at any time we want to, when we've got trading and we've got a global marketplace, particularly when it comes to retail, and hospitality is when people have a different hours they live than what they did 20 years ago, and their work and family balance, is that, you know, are the regulations which apply now the regulations which fit today?
Well, those regulations you're talking about are penalty rates, because if you work on a Sunday, you get penalty rates for working on a Sunday or a Saturday, for that matter. Are you talking about, would you like to see a move to a seven-day week where nothing is different across the 7 days?
Well, it is a seven-day week now. The hospitality awards are a seven-day week
now. Yes, but not according to the penalty rates.
Well, no, it depends on how the system works. I mean, there is a...
If you change it,
sure.
Would you like to change it?
Well, no, we've said we want the Productivity Commission to look at what the...
No, but would you like to change it? Would you like... Well, you just described why it's wrong.
Yeah.
Do you think it should change?
Well, let's have a look at what the... Sorry, Anthony?
Yeah, the government.
No, that's What's right, mate. Position? That's why we're... Well, we're having a look at it. Can I just say to that, the difference between us and the former government is we're not just going to announce something tomorrow.
That's very similar to the former government, because every time they wanted to do something, they had an inquiry.
No, they had an announcement with a card hat, usually with elbow there. But
isn't that what governments do? They have inquiries to put off making decisions?
No, not at all.
Can I?
That's what they do.
Jamie, your government does want to get rid of penalty rates, because we had Erica Betts
You're in the tent, are you, Jed? You're part of the cabinet.
The what?
You're a part of the cat. You're in the tent having discussions.
No, mate, I read the newspapers.
Yeah. Oh, right.
I saw Erica Betts last week say that he wants to make it easier for employers to trade away penalty rates. He actually said it. That's what he said, by introducing individual flexibility agreements, which are individual agreements that
people agree to sign up to.
This young lady just hit the nail on the head when she said, what power does she have as a young person working in hospitality to butt up against the power of an employer? I don't know where she works, but an employer to say, no, thanks, actually, I do want my penalty rates
on
a
Sunday. But, Jed Carney, what about the other way of looking at it, which is, what if someone was working in that 5 days and thought, actually, I wouldn't mind trading off a Friday to work on a Sunday?
This makes me cranky, you know, because... You can do. You don't have to trade off penalty rates. With the Fair Work Act right now, you can negotiate to work if you have a reasonable employer, any shift pattern you would like. But the only added difference is, just a minute, you don't have to trade off penalty rates. And what these guys want to do is add that little bit.
What's the penalty rate for the person who runs a small business?
Okay.
No, I'm not going to let you do that. No, sorry, you can't take out the question. I want to hear from the other panelists.
I have to agree with that. I mean, I run a farm.
Yeah.
And, you know, cows have to be fed and watered every single day. They don't we don't get Saturday and Sunday off. And I've never heard of the penalty tax, so I'm not an expert in this.
Penalty rates.
I understand what it is. I understand. So you pay somebody more for working weekends. I got that.
Yeah. Does that not happen at all in America?
I don't think it happens. I don't think it's a governmental thing. I've worked plenty of weekends in my life. I never got paid anymore, I'm sure of that.
They don't stop wars for weekends,
that's
true.
No,
they don't do that either. Yeah, but anyway. I was employed before I was in the Army.
Okay, Clive Palmer wants to get in. Penalty rates, should they exist?
Well, I'll just say, at peak times, the employer's got an opportunity to make more money because there's more people coming in, and you can charge higher prices for what you're selling. Yeah. So it seems reasonable, if you want to trade at that time, that the people that work for you should also benefit from that. And I employ a lot of people in resort industry, and I know a lot of the times I make more money on the weekend paying penalty rates than I do during the week. I don't begrudge paying people that, because it's their talent, their ability that allows me to trade.
The Australian says you're putting off all your workers.
Well, you don't want to believe anything you read in Australia. The Australian says that Tony Jones is not a very good journalist either, and I know you're a world champion.
You can't divert us away from the subject with compliments like that. So let's stick to the question. Are you putting off workers at your resort, for example?
Yeah, in November every year we hire people because we have a peak demand. We pay them penalty rates because they're casual workers and they're entitled to it. And then, when the peak demand stops in February or something like that, we reduce the labour. They know that. So it's a good news story in November for The Australian, where we're expanding the economy, hiring more people. It's a bad news story in February, where we're putting off people. But that's how the industry works. But if we're going to have people like that help that sort of demand, it's only reasonable that they get some sort of reward for that. And that's what we do by the penalty rates. I don't see what's wrong with it. I've got the choice whether I want to trade over the peak period and whether it's worth that much money for me.
Do you think you might have just lost the small business vote?
Well, I could have, but it's not about votes, it's about what the truth is, and sometimes you want to make everyone happy.
Anthony Albanese.
Well, this is an issue that is about our values, and Australians value the fair go, and they understand that whether it's a young woman here or the women who will clean our offices overnight in Canberra in Parliament House, who work just as hard as we do, but different jobs, but equally deserving of our respect. They're not in a position to collect, to bargain as individuals with the employer. The people on this panel are. What the government wants to do is to go back and essentially get rid of collective bargaining. They have this view that the individual can bargain with the employer, and we know that the power relationship of that results in people who are less educated, are less able to put their case, will be worse off. Driving down wages is not the Australian way.
There you go again,
Albo. I'm going to have to go back for a right of reply, a brief one.
There you go again, Albo. I mean, let's...
Well, you helped write Work Choices, James.
It is about driving down wages.
And you helped the two prime ministers, so we want to go back through our past.
Can I just put it to you, just on that subject, are you aware of a danger with this whole penalty rate story and the fear in the community that something radical might happen, that you could actually walk into a Work Choices moment?
Well, look, it is a difficult debate. There is no question. It's easy to run the emotive. It is easy to run the fear, and it's easy to run the scare. But the point is, we've got a structural challenge in our economy, and the Brotherhood of St Lawrence report today about youth unemployment, is very telling, and we've got to look at the fundamentals of the economy.
So do you think more young people would be employed if there were no penalty rates?
Well, look, I don't think it's an argument about whether there is penalty rates or not, Tony. I think the point is there enough...
But before you made the case about it being a 7-day, a week, 24-hour economy.
Well, I think there needs to be more flexibility in the system to allow people to have different arrangements where they agree to do so. And the point about that is that, you know, Jed argues passionately for her members, for the insiders, those who are in the employment market, those who've already got a job. Someone's got to argue for those who are outside the employment market.
OK, let's move on. Our next question is a video. It comes from Paul Hogan, the mayor of Greater Taree City Council in New South Wales. Not that Paul Hogan.
My question is for Jamie Briggs. The Prime Minister, Tony Abbott, has stated he wants to be remembered as the Infrastructure Prime Minister. In December last year, you publicly stated your government would honour all Commonwealth infrastructure grants, yet you have withdrawn $11.4 million in funding for local roads and bridges from the struggling community of Taree. Perhaps this is political payback in Rob Akeshott's old electorate, or is it just a lack of care for a regional community? Do Tony Abbott's aspirations include regional Australia?
Jamie Briggs. I believe he's an independent, by the way.
Sure. Well, we actually hold that seat now, the seat of Lyons. I'm not sure why we'd be paying back our own member. I'm not sure exactly about the claim. If he's talking about the so-called RDAF round fives, which were Labor election promises, sure, we didn't honour Labor election promises. They made 950 of them in their sort of get-out sale that they had in the last few weeks. So we're not committing to Labor's election promises. But what we are going to do is build the infrastructure of the 21st century. We are focused on ensuring that we've got the productive capacity throughout the economy.
But not in Taree.
In Taree, as well as across regional and urban Australia. Anthony will argue, I'm sure, that we are allegedly cutting funding, which was outside the Ford estimates for public transport projects. Well, that is true, Anthony. Outside the Ford estimates for public transport projects.
Not right.
We are saying we will focus heavily on roads, and we'll focus heavily on freight rail and other infrastructure projects. And we think the state government should pick up when it comes to urban rail projects.
I just want to briefly hear from Anthony Albanese. The mayor is an independent. It probably was a Labor election promise.
No, it wasn't, and because I'm on top of the brief. What it was something that was, unlike Jamie, it was in the budget.
I thought you weren't going to be nasty
in the budget. It wasn't a part of RDF5. It was part of properly funded projects. It was about a transport hub in the Manning Valley, about getting trucks off the local roads, and about more efficiency in terms of the freight network. It's in the budget, and like a whole lot of other things
that
were in the budget have not been funded. The mayor there has been told by Warren Truss has said one thing, but the local members said something else, and people can't get answers. But there are a range of projects. The Regional Development Australia Fund was all in the budget.
We might be able to resolve this quickly.
Well, it was part of round four. It's been funded.
Jamie Briggs.
Tell them.
If that money, if that $11.4 million was in the budget, it'll stay there.
Well, if it was in RDAF round four, we said in December we'd fund those projects that were uncontracted. It was interesting, Tony, when we got to government, there was a bunch of RDAF round four projects which weren't in Anthony's portfolio, they're in another portfolio, which weren't signed. The contracts were sitting on the desk ready to be signed when caretaker started. Just by coincidence, 90% of those fell into coalition seats. Now, how would that be? I don't know how that might be. You know, just a coincidence, probably.
OK, you're watching Q&A. Let's move on to something quite different now. Our next question comes from Nick Kelly.
Following the devastating loss of Charlotte Dawson over the weekend, there's been renewed conversation about the political approach to mental health. As someone who's seen depression and anxiety affect not only my family and friends, but myself, I know for a fact that despite the great work of organisations like Reach Out, Headspace and Lifeline, the overall approach to mental health from the community isn't currently enough to end this crippling and increasing epidemic. What more does the panel believe the government is able to do to help fix this, and why hasn't it happened yet?
Rhonda Cornum, can I start with you? I know you're familiar with this case. You've watched the news, read the papers.
I have watched, and it certainly is an unfortunate thing and devastating for the family and friends of people who commit suicide at the end of a long struggle with alcoholism, depression, etc. I'm not a psychiatrist, I'm not a psychologist, but I'm very invested in public health and health promotion, and
You are a doctor, I think.
I am. I'm a urologist. I was very involved in a mental health promotion program in the United States Army. With the belief, not that you can in any way prevent all of these kind of tragedies, but with training in optimistic thinking and good coping skills, you can decrease the rate of these kind of terrible tragedies from happening.
Now, this is a quite unusual case. The Charlotte Dawson story is a complex one. It encompasses not only mental illness, but celebrity culture. It encompasses substance abuse, marital breakdown, and wicked trolls on the internet, internet bullying, as it's sometimes called. Are you familiar with this?
Well, the only thing I saw was on the news where they were looking for evidence of such, but I hadn't seen that they'd found any.
Let's hear from Anthony Albanese. I think you knew Charlotte Dawson.
I did, and through my connection with South Sydney Football Club, so I sat at the footy with Charlotte on many occasions, and she was a bright, sparkling personality who just lit up a room, and what it does to me is just bring home, and I was quite shocked when I got the news. I had talked with her about Twitter trolls, which politicians have to put up with from time to time, the sort of thing that people think is okay to say on the internet in anonymity most of the time is just extraordinary. And I'd had discussions with her about that. I think what it does to me is just should be a real wake-up call that mental health issues can impact anyone, no matter. This was a successful, beautiful, smart woman with, you would think, everything to live for. And it's just a terrible tragedy. And we had, in my first time in Parliament when I was elected, one of our colleagues in the Labor Party chose to take his own life. That was a circumstance which I think reminded the Parliament at the time. There were lots of speeches about being kinder and gentler with each other. I don't think we've done that. I think, you know, it just, mental health issues can confront anyone. You can't tell by looking at someone. What it should do is just reinforce that resolve that I think all governments, I think the former Howard government did a lot of good work in terms of Headspace. It was built on by us through the mental health strategy with Mark Butler. I hope this is one issue that is way above politics.
Clive Palmer.
Well, I think governments can create a positive environment, and everything we hear from government tends to be negative where something's going wrong all the time. We need to have some sort of vision so we can be positive and have leadership in the community, create an environment that can help people realise that the world's not as bad as we think it is, you know. So you can only get there, I think, by being positive about the future. If you have a negative future, if you cut things, if you cut budgets, if you take things from people, you make them more worried about the future, more uncertain. And although these two politicians here, not in my party, of course, argue with each other about things, it's not about Liberal policy or Labor policy, it's what is the right policy. And the right policy should be what's right for all of us. And all of us want to have a happy future while we're on this planet. So government's got a responsibility to provide that leadership and provide that vision.
Questioner has his hand up again. I'll go back to you.
I just think we can't look at this in terms of policy. This is a really serious issue, and particularly in schools. I just finished high school a few months ago, and so many of my peers went through such awful depression and anxiety. And I think that if Mr.
Why can I just, can I ask why do you think that was?
I think it's got a lot to do with the fact that schools place too much emphasis on the sort of narrow approach of you go to school, you go to university, you get a job, you do well in life, you have a happy life. And people thinking that they want to do other things. I'm not going to university this year, I've got work opportunities. And being made to feel like doing those work opportunities wasn't the right choice definitely contributed to the anxiety that I experienced. And I think it's definitely the case for a lot of other young people.
Jed Carney.
Yeah, look, I'm trying to think of this from the perspective of a nurse. I was a nurse for 20 years and worked in the public health system most of that time, and I can see only too well the impacts this has, not only on the individual, which is tragic, but also on the extended family and ultimately on the community. And I think your question was, what can governments do? Is that, that's right. And I think it's multifaceted. I think the first thing I think Rhonda said, we have to invest heavily in preventative measures to work with schools, as you say, to make sure the teachers have the skills and the tools to actually help people in this situation, to not be so narrow, that the curriculum's broad. And the other thing I think is what we need to do is we need to be able to make sure, as a government, that there are no barriers to people getting help when they need it and how they need it. And that's
Jed,
why...
I'm just going to interrupt. There's a questioner with a hand up down the front. We'll get a microphone to you, but keep going, Jed, in the meantime.
Oh, so that's why, you know, I get... You know, Clive said it here, I get very concerned when I hear about cuts to public health and you know, maybe even making people pay to go to the GP and things that are barriers that I think we really... are policies that perhaps shouldn't really be there because they're just another barrier to a person, or particularly a young person, getting help.
OK, this lady down the front had her hand up. Go ahead.
Yes, I was just wondering, if you see a psychiatrist, you get 50 sessions partly covered by Medicare. If you see a psychologist, you only get 10 sessions. Why don't they give half each?
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what, I'll take that as a comment because it's a very complex answer for that, but I want to hear Jamie Briggs on the general question.
Well, I mean, the Charlotte Dawson scenario is awful, and it happens too often. It's terrible, you know, as Anthony said, successful, beautiful, you would think everything to live for, and obviously something pushed her to the point where she took her own life. It is an awful situation. And it happens often, you know, as local MPs, you hear stories about this all the time, sadly, and people... You don't expect, and often males. There is a problem with getting to males, particularly. So you know, I don't think we've got it right on how we address it and how we identify it. You know, the father of three young kids. It's, you know, going to school, the bullying and the online stuff. You start to contemplate. I mean, it's all very well for Anthony and I to get abused on Twitter or what have you, but it's a bit different when it's your own. Children, and you want to make sure that there is those safeguards in place. And I think, you know, everyone's got a responsibility in this. You should never say something online which you would never say to someone's face. And as Anthony says, too often people write things online which they would never say to someone's face.
Well, I just want to add just a little bit of good news to this story. Which is an otherwise miserable story, apparently. But I was just in South Australia for the last 2 weeks, and yeah. Talked to 50 schools, representatives across the spectrum from the public schools, the independent schools, Catholic schools, and they are really heavily investing in positive education and making choices and teaching about relationships and decision-making, communication, not just about whether you want to go to university or you want to go get a job. I was very impressed.
If you have any questions or need help with any of these issues, please call Lifeline 1311 4 1 3 11 14. Let's go to our next question. It's from Peter Fitzer.
My question is for Brigadier General Rhonda Cornum. As a former New South Wales police officer and PTSD sufferer, I'm personally aware of the challenges and high incidence of this condition. In what ways can the armed emergency and police services be more proactive in preventing the occurrence of PTSD and better support the sufferers and their families?
Rhonda.
Well, first of all, there is no question that post-traumatic stress disorder is it's an occupational risk for people who are in those kind of employment. I think it is important to prevent stigma for those people who seek help when they have these kind of problems. And secondly, I think like most things, psychological fitness, you should be developing that. People should be developed. There should be a program to develop that prior to being placed in really life-threatening or very stressful situations. I don't think we should wait until someone's in some kind of crisis, whether it's killing someone, watching your partner be killed, in combat, the kind of things that happen. I think that we need to have a deliberate program from the time people start in the police academy or the military services to deal and good coping with those kinds of things.
How do you prepare people for dealing with the awful things that they see and the emotions that come out of it, or even that they're involved, if it's combat or a policeman who's involved in some violent incident?
Well, interestingly, the same skill, the same sort of coping mechanism that you use for that is the same coping mechanisms you use for facing any crisis in your life, whether it is a breakup of a family, having a breast cancer diagnosis. Coping skills with disasters are really the same skills regardless of what the disaster is that's facing you. It is certainly true, however, that some occupations have a greater risk of having to face them.
Well, I mean, I think you spent time as a prisoner of war, didn't you?
I did. I spent a week as a prisoner of war when the first Gulf War, and I came out fine, and many people do. Some people don't. But when I was asked what allowed me to come through easily or well, it was the same things that got me through applying to graduate school or applying to medical school or doing anything else that was difficult. It's optimistic thinking, building good relationships, sort of self-regulation so you don't spool up and just be unable to get yourself out of catastrophic thinking and thinking the worst case is just you're stuck with it. Those are the skills that you need to learn, though, when you're a kid. It's very difficult to learn them when you're facing, like, the biggest crisis of your life. You should learn those things as young as you can and get a chance to practice them, and then a chance to practice them again and get them reinforced.
Let's move on again. Our next question is from Henry Lawton.
This is, again, for Brigadier Cobham. James Brown, the Australian military analyst and himself a veteran of the Iraq and Afghanistan wars, he's recently released a book where he's questioned how taxpayers can justify spending $325 million on the ANZAC centenary while there is a lack of support for veterans returning from the wars of the last 20 years. He's been backed by former Australian Army Chief Peter Lee. So my real question is, what is the right balance between spending on commemoration of war and helping those veterans who so badly need our help right now?
That's a tough question for you, I know, because you may or may not be aware of the ANZAC legend and the centenary that we're actually talking about. But just imagine it was a military crucible for Australia in 1915. It's something that historians say is written into our national history as well as our national
character. We just had the 150th anniversary of Gettysburg, so I think I got it.
Yep, good. Do you think we spend too much on things like that?
No, actually, I really don't think you spend too much on things like that. But I have seen sort of a lack of recognition of your military forces. It's like they disappear here. And maybe there just aren't very many, I don't know.
When they come back, you mean?
Yeah. And I have been to the Repat Foundation, I've been to your Veterans Administration, I've been to a base or two since I've been here. Whereas, as an American service member walking through an airport or something, people will shake your hand, clap when you walk down the aisle, I mean, if you're in uniform, so they can tell who you are. And I'm not even sure I've seen an Australian service member in uniform outside of a base. So it does
We're
seem
a bit more low-key as a people.
Yeah. I don't know, having just been to the fringe in Adelaide, I'm not sure that's true.
You may be right about the fringe. Anthony Albanese.
Oh, look, I I don't think it's a matter of either or.
Right.
I think the ANZAC...
But that's not, that's not what you say when it's a royal commission they're going to spend $100 million on. That's well, all too expensive.
I think the ANZAC centenary is important. I think it's an important historical moment, not just about what happened at Gallipoli, but what happened throughout World War One, including particularly in France, where I've had the honour of visiting. So I think it's important that we acknowledge that. At the same time, it's obviously very important that we look after our veterans.
Clive Palmer, briefly, do you think that money is well spent?
Well, I think it's well spent because I think we need to remember who we are, where we come from and what our nation stands for, so we can be positive about the future. But there's no question that all political parties of all governments have deserted our veterans. Are they not getting the same fair go that they should get? And I think that needs to be looked at too.
Jed Carney.
It is a difficult question. I'm not sure I can add much more to what's been said already. I think that it is an important event, but the young man raises a very important point. I mean, you know, I think that we need to look after the welfare and well-being of our returned soldiers, and that needs to be a priority.
Jamie Briggs, well, your government will be spending all that money, so I presume you endorse it.
Well, I think what Anthony said is right. You can walk and chew gum at the same time, and this is a one-off expenditure versus recurrent expenditure about dealing with people or having provision for people who deserve to be looked after when they've served their country and put their lives on the line for the rest of us. So, you know, I think you can do both.
OK, we've got time for one last question. This one's from Madeline Gilmore.
This is a question for Mr Palmer, and it's in relation to the Western Australian election, where Mr Palmer has said he hopes to get two Senate seats, which would give him a strong balance of power in the federal parliament. Mr Palmer, it's been reported that you have mocked the voters who voted for you in your electorate of Fairfax. That report being, and I quote, and it's from a former security guard of yours, he can be as nice as pie when he wants something, and he wanted to be elected. He promises them everything, shakes their hand, does the baby kissing thing, the whole thing. But then he said to me, well, that went well, Mike, I got them all effed, expletive. Now, you have never denied those words.
Well, I can deny it now, too.
No, you have never denied those words. You'll toss them off as being reported by the Australian.
Oh, well, that doesn't surprise me.
I understand that Mr Hennessy will put those on affidavit
can
evidence.
Can I answer the question?
No, I haven't finished yet, Mr Palmer.
All right, so, better get to the end of your question because we're running out of time.
So you've never denied the words. You've never costed any of your policies, just made wild promises. The leader of your Queensland Palmer, United Palmer, Alex Douglas, has described your supporters as bogans. Do you think the voters in Western Australia are as gullible as those who have voted for members of your party in the past?
Well, first of all, the West Australian election, really, we know who the Prime Minister is, we know who the Leader of the Opposition is. It won't make any difference. Only by voting for our party will Western Australia be part of the balance of power.
Can I please answer
the question?
Don't
interrupt me while I'm answering it then. I'm trying to answer the question for you. I've never said those words. The person that you've quoted was somebody that was dismissed from our employment for bad behaviour and for being drunk on duty. That's the reality of it, and we would do that. That's entirely fabrication. It's not new to me if it's written in The Australian, because Rupert Murdoch wants to control this country, and that's what it's all about. Now, and that's the truth, you know. So I've got no doubt that what you're saying is just rubbish, and it's not true. I've never said that. And I've stood as a person in the House of Representatives, not from the major political parties. And it's up to the people of Fairfax to decide if they want to elect me. And they did want to elect me because I'm here. And you've got to respect their opinion. I respect them. Elections come and go. Politicians are not important. It's ideas that really matter. And we need to get this country moving again and be positive about the future. What you've said is just not true. It's the old politics where people say, you're bad, you're good. It doesn't really matter. In the final analysis, what matters is what's good for Australia.
OK, I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there. That argument may have to be settled at another time. Thank you. Now, that is all we have time for tonight. Please thank our panel, Clive Palmer, Anthony Albanese, Brigadier General Rhonda Cornum, Jed Carney and Jamie Briggs. Thank you. Thanks to some very good questioners as well in the audience. Now, next Monday, we'll be joined by the Parliamentary Secretary to the Prime Minister, Josh Frydenberg, the Shadow Communications Minister, Jason Clare, businesswoman and Chair of Manufacturing Australia, Sue Morfitt, and musician and Pacific rights advocate, David Bridie. So until next week, good night.